Whoa, it's Woolsey. Welcome back to another Geometry Dash building video. You guys seem to love the effect videos, so I'm back again with a new limitation. For this video, I'm only allowed to use corner pieces, which could either be amazing or terrible. I guess we'll find out today, but as these are small objects, I'm gonna have to use a lot of them. So, you can expect lag today. Once again, I'm going to be working without music in this video, just making a few standalone backgrounds or effects. And thank you for the immense support lately, let's not forget that. We just hit 51k subs so soon after the 50k barrier. You guys are going so crazy, but I challenge you to go even more crazy. Let's see if we can hit 52k by the end of October. Much love. And I forgot to pee before I started recording. All right, locked and loaded. Let's go. We're gonna choose the gradient background on a dark gray. Not quite black because I feel like that's a bit too harsh. To get myself warmed up, I'm gonna do something that was pretty popular in 2.0 with my own little spice on it. I'm just gonna set a ship portal underneath the level real quick that is invisible, just so I can see the blue borders of where the top of the screen will be. Let's make our way into the corner piece tab, and we're gonna start placing in corner pieces into the level with the moving group 2. The layering doesn't really matter because it's gonna be going on black blending, which I always make color channel 10. I'm gonna turn off preview mode because these will be invisible. I wanna see what's what. We're just gonna randomly place them, maybe half space a couple, just in a couple of different places. I don't know, there's not much coordination in this. We have our object placed in. I'm gonna go from top to bottom and just select them in rows, giving them a different number. A couple will share the same number. So we have 2 here that are on 4. The top 3 are on 3, 13, and 14 is at the bottom. Okay, then we're going to select the whole set. We're going to enable link controls, because apparently I have that turned off at the start of every video. We're going to link those together. I've moved them to the side a little bit, and I've given them the group 15. I'm going to copy paste and start scaling these. Little by little, I'm going to put this on editor layer 1 and start giving them a unique group every time. So this one's 16, then when we scale again, it's going to be 17. So you'll see an effect immediately. The ones towards the middle have little to no displacement between the dots. However, the ones on the edges have quite a lot. So this is going to create a 3D looking effect, which is centered around the middle and the dots are shooting around the outside. Now, one thing I want to quickly add before we go a bit further with this is a hue change on each layer. And it's going to be a bit annoying to select each one, but I'm glad we're making this change now instead of later. I'm going to change the hue by +3, which isn't going to make a difference yet because these dots are currently on black blending, but once we start adding pulses for these, it's going to make a difference. So we just increment the hue by +3 every time. The last one was +9, so we're adding this to +12. Now we can continue the process of increasing the scale by 0.01, adding a new group, and incrementing the hue by +3, all the way out to max scale. Okay, so I finished it up and I scaled it down. It reached -57 hue at the end and group 113. And I want to show you a problem I had with the scaling of this. Now, as you can see, there's a bit of a problem with the editor that the scale goes past a certain point when there's a bunch of objects with different scales. I'm not too sure the conditions of where this happens, but you can see if I just keep on moving my mouse around on the right, these dots just keep on scaling up, even though it should be at its max. There's definitely inconsistencies in the scaling and the spacing of these dots, and they're not even loading in properly in the editor, which isn't helping. They're all still there, and it works properly in normal mode, and the gaps between the dots shouldn't be too noticeable anyway because of the pulses and movements that I'm about to add. I'm going to start off with some pulses that begin on group 15. Short fade in and a short fade out, just on a pale red. Now, because I changed the hue of all the dots, it's not going to be that same color all the way around. It will have different hue, but this is what the base pulse trigger is going to be like. Okay, here we go, group 113. Then we're going to select the bottom trigger, add that as the group parent, select the rest of the pulse triggers, and we can rotate it around that point, just like that. Going to add a mix of hues and saturations with this. So I'll be moving around this little circle a lot as well. This is what we've got so far. Pretty cool looking, but it's pretty static. Remember the groups that I added in rows earlier? Hell yeah, we're gonna start adding a wiggly movement for them. Yay! We're moving them for 2 seconds, 2 blocks to the left, and then once this movement ends, they'll move double the distance the opposite way. I'm pretty sure you know how it works. We shall do the rotation thing again, copy paste, move it 17 blocks to the right. So the next movement starts before the previous one ends. That's how I'm gonna make it a lot smoother. Now the top row is moving a lot sooner than the bottom row, and it's making a wiggly effect. Then we're gonna apply pretty much much the same thing to each individual scale of particle that's moving right here. Start on 15 again. We're going to change it on the y-axis this time. I think it's only going to be half the distance though. So I'm going to start with minus 10 instead of minus 20. Just some more copy-paste. You know how it is. Boom. 113. Right. Now it's time to select all of these move triggers and do a little rotating. Yeah, that looks just about right to me. I'm also going to play with the easing. I don't want to just do an ease in out because that will get boring. I want to try a bounce out and move it the opposite direction, double the distance. And these are 2 seconds apart on a 3 second move time. So the next movement starts before the last one ends. So let's see what we're looking at now. It should have a pretty dynamic movement with the bounce. Oh yeah, look at it go. I love how they kind of bend like that. It's sick. But we can make it a whole lot cooler by just going to this layer, selecting all of these objects, going on to a new editor layer, maybe two. We're gonna flip it and then move it into the center again, maybe with a little half space. I've set up an alpha trigger for group 115, which is gonna be on 40% opacity. And we can use that for the extra layers that we are adding right now. So it's looking pretty good with the extra layers. I want some to be a bit more opaque and a bit larger. So I'm going to go back to the original layer that we added, which is on editor layer 1. And we'll start scaling them up ever so slightly, just around itself. And then there's going to be a flipped horizontally and vertically set that's going to be 1.5. And I'm going to put that on a color channel, which copies color channel 10 with blending. So this is black blending at the moment, then increasing the hue by hue 180. We're going to rock with this, whatever it is. I think it's going to look sick. Hell yeah, look at the particles I've created now. Yes, the bounce is actually super cool. I really enjoy it. It's quite unpredictable in the way that it moves. And we have just created the 2.2 particle editor in 2.1. Next up, I want to make some patterns with dots instead of just random displacements. So I want to make a 50 by 50 diamond shape in the middle of the screen by just using dots. And to do that, I'm going to need 196 different dots. Now, all of these dots are going to be collected in the middle. So all I have to do is just add a dot to a moving group that locks to the x-axis, which is right here. That locks forever. Then we need to give it a unique group, which is going to move it individually to its own spot in the diamond shape. So what I have to do is keep copy-pasting and increasing the group by 1. And this shouldn't take too long. Look at the speed I am brushing through these right now. Oh my goodness gracious. Okay, we are approaching group 198. Awesome. Now it's time to make our move triggers, and this is the most important part. So, starting off with 3, that's going to move 50 along to the left, which is 5 blocks. So if I put a move trigger out there that moves it back the way, it's seamless and it goes back in very nicely. Okay, gonna have to repeat a process on this trigger and then the opposite on this trigger. So it's gonna take a little bit of a while, but it's definitely gonna be worth it. Now, what I gotta do is make sure that 4 goes one less on the x-axis and one further up. And if I repeat this a couple of times, you'll see why. If I just delete the second movement for a second, you'll see how that moves outwards. There we go. So it's gonna make that diamond shape. If I just continue making them add up to 50, this might take a little while just because it's a little bit finicky to add one on each slider every single time. Okay, so as we approach Y50, I gotta keep sliding the X to the right, but I gotta start decreasing the Y. And by them adding up to 50, I mean the magnitude of them adding up to 50. Like I was saying, this equals 50. It definitely doesn't. We've just crossed 50 and 0. We're now going negative on both X and Y by 1 every time. And I've got something exciting to show you. I tested a rotation earlier on the triggers, so there's a delay in each, which I wasn't really planning, but look how it looks, man. That looks so cool. Well, I've reached 198 and I've not met back up with what I have, so I feel like I've miscalculated a little bit and there's no duplicate. Boom, now we got the full shape. Awesome. But now we gotta move it back in, which is pain. Nice, that whole side goes in perfectly. Oh my god, this is it. This is it. This is the last trigger I need to place. Oh my god. Thank you. Oh my god. Yes, it goes out and it goes back in again, and then it goes back out again. And then it goes in again. That's so cool. So let me put that first set on editor layer 1. Then I can select it all, copy paste, go to the next editor layer, and build helper. So now there's 2 layers of the same thing. That looks cool. And we can change the easing on them. This is going to be awesome. I want to rotate this so the bottom of the pillar is like at the same time as the previous. Let's go. So that's the second layer right there. Oh my god, that's so cool. And it attaches. Dude, look at it. Oh my god. And then we can add even more layers to that and make it look even more epic. So this has four layers to it now. And my process for doing that was copy pasting, moving it five, and then rotating it back to the same spot that it started. As you can see, the first trigger in each rotation is on the same block. For the last effect in this video, I want to have a rotation-based effect, which is going to have a centerpiece in the middle with the unique group 3, the invisible group 1, and the moving group 2, and then this corner piece, it's going to extend down with unique groups extending from 4. I need to set up a rotation trigger for group 4 around 3. We'll say 5 seconds for now with a bounce, because the bounce ones are always the coolest. 360 degree rotation. Then it's just simple. I select both of these things, link them together, move it down one tiny little arrow, and build helper. I knew it would change the center. This is so problematic for anything I ever want to do. Okay, so I just gotta accept that with build helper, it's always gonna change the center group ID no matter whether I have it selected or not. So I just gotta make sure that this always goes back to 3. Okay, so I'm not extending it all the way down to the bottom. We already have 480 divided by 2 groups used. So I'm just gonna go back to these triggers, set the center to 3, and rotate these a little bit, move it to the side. And if I've done this correctly, this should make a curvy pattern. Oh, that is weird to look at. It's so wobbly. So hopefully I can then copy paste and flip this. Yeah, I can. There we go. It looks floppy. It's like a mirror image now. I want to keep on rotating this, I guess. That's not centered either. Why is the game like this? It's got to be to do with the hitbox of the corner piece. I can probably half space it. Yep. That is exactly the solution. Unless I flip it like that and have it the opposite way on the inside. Oh, dude, that's cool. Okay, we can definitely do something there. Hopefully, the game will realize that the center point is in the middle and it will let me scale upwards. Why is the game like this? I don't understand. Oh my god, bruh. I had absolute scaling turned on. Are you kidding me? Dude, it's rotating each corner piece around its center point. Oh my god. Dude, I could have done this the whole time and I was just bugging out. Hey yo, I think this is a pretty cool effect I got going on. It spins and it reverses. I just think it looks so cool. I'm still pretty happy with how this has turned out. I could definitely be using a lot of different colors, but the shape is the most important thing here for me. I just think it's so cool when it's spinning around, how it kind of spirals and makes a kind of floral pattern. Hold on, what if I just put these on zero move time? Okay, let me change it by 10 then, and then copy paste this every couple of blocks. And I'm gonna link one of these together just in case it breaks. Oh! That's pretty nice. Okay, I'm rocking with that one for sure. When I scaled these triggers up, did I have absolute scaling on? I better not have. I feel like I just did, and yeah, that makes a lot more sense. Hold on, we can make this cooler. Let me do the step-by-step thing first, and then we can have a bouncy thing afterwards. Let me just get it set up. Hey, look at the rate that's happening now. I think it's still a frame rate limit. What? Oh my god, that was nuts. Dude, this one might actually be the coolest. If there was different colors, imagine how hard this would go. So we got fireworks, which is the first one we made in this video, and probably my favorite because of how colorful it is. And the way it kind of resembles the 2.2 particle editor. I love the unpredictable nature of it. The diamond one I've been tweaking on and off. This combines ease in out and I think exponential in out. Makes a pretty cool pattern right there. And then this one kind of grew on me. I really like the individual rush that this has going on. And the way it transitions into that rotation. Oh my. It's so sick, dude. I love these. Anyway, that was the corner piece only effect challenge. I want to make more effects with restrictions like these. I think it's cool. I don't know. With corner pieces, there's a lot of potential, but also a lot of limits because of the hitbox of the corner piece. I don't know, it acts kind of weirdly. But thank you so much for watching this Geometry Dash effect video. Check the links in the description, leave a like and subscribe, and have a good day.